Ted Sorensen was born in Lincoln, Nebraska, and graduated from Lincoln High School and then the University of Nebraska-Lincoln with bachelor's and law degrees. He went on to serve as special counsel, advisor, and speechwriter for John F. Kennedy from 1953 until Kennedy's assassination in 1963.
When it gets down to a single line in a single speech that resonates through the ages.
I think I know what the next question is. And having been asked that same question several thousand times in the last 38, 40 years, obviously I've developed a standard answer to that question.
Which is?
A standard answer to that question I know you're about to ask?
Mm-hmm.
Ask not.
Which takes me full circle. At this point, why not give credit where credit may be due, whether it's purely with the president or with his speechwriter?
Just not my nature, sorry. You can find in the archives members of the press, authors, historians, and others who've given me enormous credit. You'll even find quotations from John F. Kennedy, who making extravagant statements about my role and importance, and so on. I was always embarrassed when those statements became public, whether they came from him or from some newspaper reporter or others. Whether it's because the first thing a speechwriter should learn is anonymity and modesty.
Even 40, 50 years after the fact.
Yes. I know that's not the modern practice. Now it's about 40 or 50 minutes after the fact that some speechwriters go out and claim credit, but that's just not my way.
When working on the themes of that speech,
which one, the inaugural?
The inaugural.
Some great themes, which resonated throughout his administration.
What were the key themes that the president really wanted to emphasize?
I'll tell you a line in that speech that I think became extremely important in the Kennedy administration, and in many ways was as important or more important than the line about ask not what your country can do for you. And that was the line in which he said, only when our arms are sufficient beyond a doubt, can we be certain beyond a doubt that we will not need to use them. That was the Kennedy approach to war and peace. If we are sufficiently well armed, if we have an edge over others, we're not going to declare war. We're not going to attack and overwhelm others, but neither will they attack us. He makes several references to, I don't remember the exact words, poverty and misery in the world. Other presidents just, at least since Truman, simply have largely ignored the conditions under which most of the world lives. Now we're beginning to realize that ignoring it has consequences. Ignoring it means that other countries, other peoples will resent us and will be ripe for recruitment into the ranks of those who hate us and would do ill to us. So Kennedy, that was another recurring theme. He also talks about world law and international organizations several times in that speech. Talks about human rights. Talks about finding a way to work together on major projects and problems with the Soviet Union. This is in the middle of the Cold War. And he says, together let's explore our ways to explore the planets, to push back the deserts, to conquer the ancient ills of man, poverty, hunger and war itself. Even in his inaugural address, he was looking forward to the possibility of cooling down, if that's not an anomaly, in terms of the Cold War, tempering it down.